And welcome, my friends, to yet another episode of the Mind Dog TV podcast. I'm Matt Napo. Thanks for coming. It's great to have you here, as always. A wonderful Saturday afternoon episode of the program. We don't do a lot of Saturday afternoons around here. As you know, I kind of just put it out there, give the guests the options. They pick the dates and times between either 1 p.m. usually or 8 p.m. and very rarely do we get a 1 o'clock show on a Saturday. So this is kind of unusual for me, especially on a night after a gig. we'll get to the program in just a minute. First, I want to start out by mentioning our sponsor today is Sam Ash, samash.com. If you're a musician, you know all about Sam Ash. If you're in sound production, you should probably know all about Sam Ash. If you're a podcaster like me, Sam Ash is the place to go for great equipment to help you get started and make the best out of your podcast equipment wise. And so click the link in the description, samash.com. You're going to save just by clicking our link. So it's a great place to get all the equipment that you need for sound reinforcement, DJs, music, podcasters, and anybody who's looking for any type of sound reinforcement or recording equipment, samash.com. And I hope you support them. My voice sounded a little gravelly today. It's because I was out playing with the band last night, and the gig after, actually it was just an acoustic duo, but a day after a gig is always a little weird with my voice. Sometimes I wake up with a really, really low voice, and it takes hours to come back. The viewer mail, listener mail, is always something that keeps me interested, and lately I've been getting a lot of several emails. I shouldn't say a lot, several. Out of all the people that listen to this podcast, I guess maybe 10 or 20 is not a lot, really. But so the questions coming in are that I've been a little more confrontational, maybe, with some of the questions I've asked the guests. And believe me, it's not intended to be that way. And I don't think my guests have taken it that way. But apparently some people in the audience have listened to it and come away with that feedback. So I'll be more mindful of it. The idea behind all these questions is trying to use me as a surrogate. So if there's something I don't understand and need illuminated or really explained deeper, I'm thinking that probably some people in the audience are also in the same place as me. Now, obviously, not everybody thinks like me, but when some questions come up, I feel it's important for me to get clarity so that the audience could get clarity on it. And that's the whole reason behind the questions. I never look to be confrontational with the guests or think that I know more than them. I wouldn't be doing this and I wouldn't have them here if I knew more than them. I'm here to learn from them and hopefully serve as a surrogate for you people who listen to the program so that you can learn from them. Before I did the podcast, I never met anybody named Roman in my entire life. Since I've done the podcast, I've met 10 people named Roman. It's just weird. Just a weird observation. All of a sudden, I know a lot of people named Roman. After 60 years, I finally started meeting people named Roman. It's just a very strange thing. I feel like I've signed up for a course that I've failed a number of times, too many to count. Today's show is all about relationships. And my guest today happens to be named Roman. is somebody who helps people create relationships that are the envy of people who see them from the outside. So it's going to be my great pleasure to learn from my guest today. Please open your ears, open your minds, and help me welcome in Roman Mironov. Roman, welcome to the Mind Dog TV podcast. Thanks for coming.
Hi, Matt. It's a pleasure to be with you today, even though it's Sunday. What about Saturday?
Yeah. So Saturdays are a little weird, and usually I don't even feel awake until 4 p.m., but I'm happy to be here with you, and I'm happy to have the opportunity to learn something from you. So tell me a little bit about your backstory, that why you became, I don't know how we classify it. Is it a relationship coach, relationship counselor? How would you describe it?
Yeah, that's a coach. I am a relationship coach, and I'm trained by Robbins Medina's Training Center, which is a program, training program of Tony Robbins. And my original story is first, I went through a painful divorce 6 years ago, and I was terrible in that marriage. So I realized that, you know, I could apply that painful experience to helping other people. That was one thing. And then after my divorce, I actually had to put myself out there and go dating, create relationships. And I actually learned quite a lot. And I got to practice every relationship and dating tip on myself, making myself a guinea pig. So I wanted to share that knowledge with other people. And then I also came to Canada last year from Russia. I lived in Russia for 36 years, and now I'm in Canada, and I switched my careers. I did a huge career transition from a translator to a coach.
Wow. Is the nature of relationships a little different in a different culture like Russia compared to Canada?
Yeah, there are differences. There are differences. For example, Russia is more conservative in many ways. So relationships are more conservative. People get married more often than compared to Canada.
Right. You mentioned dating just a moment ago. I think most people, even people who are caught up in chronic dating, I call it, or endless cycles of dating, I think most people really hate the whole idea of dating. It's like going to a store and trying to pick out a person. It's shopping for people. Most people are pretty uncomfortable with it. What is your take on the whole structure of dating and how we find prospective partners in life?
First of all, I totally agree with you. People do feel anxious about dating, especially because many people are simply introverts. And even those who are extroverts, they sometimes do not have the skills, the specific dating skills to, you know, to go out and meet people. And to answer your second question about meeting, the love of your life, I think my best tip is actually to do something about it, to get more socially active, to go out actually. Because so many people, they do want to meet that, you know, great person for themselves, but they never do anything.
Specifically, what do you mean by that? Do what?
Okay, I think there are three components to it. The first one is to put yourself out there, go for walks, go to parks, go to places where people are. You know, strike up conversations and see where it goes. That's one thing. The other thing is, of course, use online dating websites. I know a lot of my clients and just, you know, people that I know, they believe that online dating is brutal. That's true. But so it's a numbers game, but you still have to do it, especially because now so many people are on those websites. And the third thing that I recommend is actually joining groups of people, like, or communities of people with similar interests. Well, let's say there is a group that goes on a hike every Saturday, and you join that group, and it's quite likely that you'll find someone there.
Excellent advice there. Now I want to stay on this idea of, because I want to stay on the idea of dating. Sometimes I cut myself off, like I'm interrupting myself mid-sentence, which is very weird. I'm noticing that about myself more and more. So we're in the subject of dating. And I think when you get into relationships problems, I think, and you can correct me if I'm wrong about this, but my take on that is the reason we get into those things is because people were too quick to create a relationship out of dating when they should have taken the time to really get to know the person a little better before committing to a relationship. I'm guessing that was a car going past your place, not my place. But so on that subject, the process of dating, and sometimes people tend to get into a relationship quickly, and that will cause problems rather than taking your time. Talk to that a little bit if you can.
Yeah. Taking your time is definitely a very good idea. And in my experience, the best time frame for getting into a relationship is something about 2 months.
So wow.
I would not recommend to rush into a relationship before that. That's one thing. The other thing, if you are a man, don't talk about relationships. That's your woman's domain. So let her bring up the question. Let her tell you that she wants a relationship with you. Because if she doesn't, it means that you're doing something wrong.
That's wow. That's interesting. So do you get a lot of pushback on that idea? Because, the world is so... we want everything to be like equal, and the idea that the equality in everything, and women and men should be equal in every single way. And I don't think we were created that way. I don't think it's our nature to be that way, to be equal in all things. Of course, in opportunity and career and stuff like that, you want that stuff politically, to be an even playing field for. Gender shouldn't count. But when it comes to relationships, I don't think we're created equally. And I agree with you that there are roles that are more suited to a man and more suited to a woman. But I'm just curious if you get any pushback by what you just said, because that definitely is not politically correct in these times.
I do get a lot of pushback as a coach, definitely, in a lot of these types of situations, these types of, suggestions. And well, I always say, okay, it's not my job to sell my perspective, but I always tell my clients, you go try it yourself. And it oftentimes works, because people come to me actually after trying a lot of things and they did not work. And that's when I explain this to them. First, they have a pushback. But when they think about it and they really become aware of what they did in the previous relationship, they realize that, yeah, that could have been the problem.
Now staying on this idea of political correctness, and I really don't want to stay here too long, but because you said man and a woman, I'm sure I'm going to get emails from people calling us homophobic for assuming that every relationship has to be a man and a woman. Do you work at all with gay or bisexual couples or any of that kind of stuff? Or is that something you don't really work with?
I think I could work with them, but I've never done so because I haven't. They did not come to me.
That's an interesting thing too. I want, and I'm putting that out there. If you want to send me an email at info@minddogtv.com, do gay couples or lesbian couples seek out relationship coaches or marriage counselors or relationship counselors in the same way that heterosexual couples do? I'm interested in that. I don't know. So educate me on that. So it's just, I wanted to put that out there because I know I'm going to get hate mail calling me a homophobic because we addressed it as a relationship between a man and woman. Now, moving on, had a comic on last week and we were talking, and I don't want to get too graphic here, but there's a piece I posted this morning from Jonesy about, I really have to say it. He said in his comedy, he does a piece about a woman with a penis. And he says basically that, there are worse things. Every relationship is a trade-off. And you have to, in a relationship, accept some things about your partner that are not exactly the way you might have envisioned your perfect mate to be in your life. And so his comedy bit as well, there are more annoying things than a woman with a penis. And he said, we've all been in relationships where we have to accept something that's really annoying about our partner. So I want to take that a step further with you. Do we have to settle and really get to that place where we're not, recognizing first that you're not perfect and that your mate is never going to be perfect. So take off the filter of idolization and try and stop trying to see them as a perfect person and accept their faults. Your take on what I just said, and you can leave out the woman with the penis part.
Yeah, you're totally right. I think there are two components to it. The practical component is that you will never be able to find an ideal person. That's not going to happen because our world is flawed in its foundation, and hoping for like being a perfectionist never works.
Right.
It's just not going to work. And on a more philosophical level, relationships are all about unconditional love, and you need to cultivate unconditional love in yourself in order to accept your partner with, you know, all their like shortcomings or whatever you perceive as shortcomings, because they're just differences.
Yeah, you know, I have a problem with this concept of unconditional love. I understand complete love, and I understand that when you're in love with somebody or love somebody, there's different kinds of love. There's being in love, like Eros love, romantic love, and then there's love, which is general care and consideration for somebody else with love. But this idea of unconditional love, there's always a condition. And I come back to another comedian, Daniel Tosh, who talks about this, where we, and his thing is about, you know, basically a man hitting a woman, and which I'm not condoning, believe me, and I'm not going there. But his idea is it's never okay for a man to hit a woman. And he says, well, yeah, there's some gray area there. What if you come in and your wife she just killed your two children and drowned them in the bathtub, and she's about to dunk the third. Is it okay to hit her then? So in my warped thinking, that means there's a condition to everything. So if your wife is killing your children, is that unconditional love still there? No, there's a condition there. The condition is you don't kill my children and I will love you. But so that idea of unconditional has some boundaries and some limitations, so it's not really ever no conditions, is it?
Well, if you think of such extreme conditions as killing your kids, yeah, well, perhaps.
I understand it's extreme, but I think you need to take that in my mind. You know, when words have power, so when you use the word unconditional, that means there's absolutely no condition. So you have to kind of draw the lines of, and I'm not saying think this thing all the way completely through like that. Is this person a potential killer? But the realization that there are some conditions that are going to be applied here, no matter what, and there are some deal breakers. No?
Look, again, there are two points. I think there are two perspectives on this. The first one is practical. From the practical perspective, of course, when it comes to, you know, like killing children or being very, very...
Well, even, you know, you don't have to go that extreme. Think about adultery. In some people, adultery is a deal breaker, and so that's the condition which I cannot accept. So, if you're suggesting, and again, this goes back to that email. I'm not being confrontational here. I'm trying to learn, but the idea that there are no conditions when there obviously is a condition that you don't cheat on me is the condition. Is that acceptable or not? Are you saying unconditional love means even that is like off the table?
You know, when it comes to adultery, I think that this is not exactly about unconditional love, but it's more about values. So for example, if a couple agreed on their values before getting together and they decided that one of the values is loyalty, it just means that they broke the value. And And that's it. That's why, for example, they want like to part ways.
Right. So on that note, Do you only, when you talk about relationships, are we really just talking about romantic relationships and love relationships like a spouse, or do you work on relationships that go beyond that? Just, you know, because everything is a relationship. My interaction with my coworkers is a relationship. My interaction with my band, this is a friendly relationship. Co-host to guest is a relationship. Do you work with people on that kind of stuff, or is it strictly what we call love relationships?
Yeah, I work on all kinds of relationships, especially because people might come to me with a romantic relationship issue, but you know, as we delve into their challenges and I get to know them better, it always, you know, takes us into deeper things, including, and probably most important, their relationship to themselves.
Gotcha. I'm going to put up your website right now. We're going to talk a little bit about it. RomanMironov.com. It's all one word for the people on the audio side, which is just about everybody. RomanMironov.com. Of course, their link will be in the description, nice and clickable for you to click on. But in case you are one of those people who like to take the podcast while driving or whatever you're doing and just want to be able to have an audio reminder of it, it's RomanMironov.com. So do you work with people only? I know you're based in, I didn't even mention this, in Toronto, Canada. Do you just work with people in your area, or do you do remote kind of stuff like this kind of stuff?
I do both.
You do. So people can contact you through your website and arrange something, even if they're in Australia.
Yeah, absolutely. I help people from all over the world. Yeah.
And so how does that begin? Does it begin with typically what would they expect in working with you?
Well, let's say one of my most recent clients, he watched a YouTube video that I did. He liked what I was saying. He related to me. And then he reached out and said, I have this sort of problem in my relationship with my wife. And I would like your.
And so how are these things like long term, or is it usually like maybe succession? How does, you know, what people, I'm just trying to set expectations for when people get involved in this. I know a lot of people, because I've been through marriage counseling, I guess you would call it. And you go there and you kind of have to set your expectations, because a lot of people think this is going to be a quick fix. We're just going to go there and work on this one problem, which may be just a symptom of a much larger problem, and you never really understand what you're getting into until you really kind of get honest and have that third party, I want to call them like non-committed referee in a relationship. So I'm trying to set expectations. How long do these things usually last, or can it be short? Can it be long term? How does it go?
Great question. My recommended length is usually six sessions.
Six sessions.
Six sessions. Sometimes people come with a very, very simple problem that does not require any like coaching work. So they're just looking for an advice. That could take just one session, right? And there is another group of people. There are actually quite many of them. And they keep working with me on a long-term basis.
Hmm. Okay. So my experience with this, and it's not like I have a lot of experience with it, but I have some experience with it. Right. My experience is that generally one side of the relationship will be the one pushing to go to a coach or a counselor or whatever you call it. And the reason they want to do that is so that you can help prove them right. Because everybody wants to be right. And do you experience that?
Yeah, sure. And they come because they don't like something in their partner and they want to change them. Yeah, they believe that they're right.
Right. And so how do you handle that? Do you cut that, nip that in the bud, as they say, in the first session and say, I'm not here to take sides one person or the other, or the other. I'm here to kind of be impartial. Do you do that right from the start or not?
Yeah, of course, I'm 100% impartial. And, you know, when it comes to when it comes to seeing that my client wants to change something in their partner, I tell them right away that this is impossible. You can only change yourself. You can't change your partner.
Mm-hmm. That's an interesting idea. I mean, I think I would agree with that, certainly. But I think that you can make somebody aware of shortcomings that they are not really even aware that they have. Well, I don't want to shortcomings. See, it's hard for me to find the right words, but issues that they might have that they're not even aware of, and make them aware of it, and then they might decide to change on their own. Is that what this is all about, really?
Well, that's one component of it. And the second component, which is more important, is actually changing yourself and becoming a better partner. And by doing that, making your partner want to change.
Huh. Well, that seemed like a difficult thing. Can you elaborate on the process of that? Obviously working on yourself, that's an easy part, but the understanding of how changing yourself would make your partner want to change. I think because when most people get into this part where they're in a relationship and they're butting heads and it seems like there's no moving forward because we've hit an impasse and we can't get around it. It seems like there's one issue that's the real issue, when it could be a lot more, but that's the one that's keeping them from having a peaceful and happy relationship. I think it's just because I changed myself doesn't mean that person's going to recognize that and want to change because I've changed that. Or do you think I'm wrong about that? That, yeah, just recognizing the change in you would make me want to change.
Well, let me give you a practical example. Let's say a couple lost their spark, and they don't communicate too well. They don't spend time together. They just, take care of the kids. They go to work. They go come home, have dinner, and that's it. They don't talk. And the wife doesn't like it. The husband seems fine with that, but she doesn't like it, and she wants to change it. So one thing that she can do, she can get interested in what the husband is doing. First of all, she can ask him a lot of quality questions about his work, because she has probably stopped doing that like months or years ago. That's one thing. And the other thing, she could join him in what he's doing. Well, let's say he sits down to watch a football match. She can join him. She can actually be engaged.
Hmm. So that's a kind of unique concept to me. Because most of the time, I think people want to be right. So I believe in my situation, I'm the right one, and you're not hearing me. You're not right. You don't think like I do. You're not seeing my point of view. And in the end, what I'm really trying to get is you to submit to my will. I think that's a big part of just about every time I've gotten to that point in a relationship. And I've had a lot of relationships in my, been married twice. I'm married now, my second marriage, but a lot of relationships in between, a long road of many, many years of being an older person now. But every time I've been in that place where we weren't moving forward, it was generally that, one person wants to be the winner. Yeah. So how do you address that? Because I, even in counseling or coaching, that doesn't go away. And sometimes we don't even recognize it when we're in that state, even though somebody is telling you completely directly, I think you're just trying to be the winner here.
I address this with just one question. Do you want to be happy or do you want to be right?
Oh, I think most people want to be right. Am I wrong? because happiness, listen, happiness, we talk about happiness on this program all the time. Happiness is, there's never a permanent state of happiness, right? Right. So, but there is a permanent state in right. Being right is permanent. So I think that's why we gravitate more towards, you know, wanting to be right. And I could be wrong, but that's how my take on that. And so, you know, I see a lot. I've seen a lot of it in my own personal relationships where we hit a roadblock because neither one of us wants to be wrong. Right. And so getting out of that, you know, where you break that down and say it's OK to be wrong and it's OK to admit you've made a mistake here and realign your values and principles to what we really say and, you know, the real thing rather than just words that we've been using and talking points.
Yeah.
So it's kind of, do you believe in, are you a proponent of contracts like, in a relationship and, you know, written agreements of this is how we're going to move forward and this is what we do?
I like them personally, and I definitely discuss them with my clients to see if they will make sense to them. So for example, I love Stephen Covey, and in his book, The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People, he actually recommended having this document, a mission statement for the family.
Right. But I think why a lot of us get into relationships, and there could be lots of different reasons, first of all, but a lot of us like that feeling of love, that initial contact of, and that initial feeling of being in love with somebody. So doesn't that contract stuff make it more business-like and kind of kill that? What the reason people got into the relationship in the first place was to feel that feeling of being in love, and now you're making it almost like a business decision. Does that ruin it?
Yeah, I get this question all the time, and again, the answer is like, do you want to be happy? Or do you want to be like anal about this?
Right. Well, I think, you know, and I've never had one of those contracts, but I know it's become more popular over the years, especially as relationship counseling and coaching, whatever you want, however you want to define it, has become more popular. People have gotten more into that. And I don't really know, because I've never had one, on whether they really work and help marriages or relationships sustain. Do you have any, is there any data on that, on whether that really helps for a long term?
There might be. I haven't seen it.
Yeah. where was I going to go with that? I forgot where, you know, this is the first time that's ever happened to me where I, on the air, where I forgot where I was going with leading into that question. But, so in your experience, do these people who come to you, are they open to this idea of, you know, we need to write it down?
It depends on the person. Usually I'm pretty convincing about that.
You are?
Yeah, so they, because you don't have to go all in right away. You can start with something simple, like just writing down your responsibilities. So responsibilities that each family member has. Start from there. And then you can go with, like, well, let's say a month, after trying this for a month, you can go into values. So write down the values that your family wants to uphold. And so you take it step by step.
So now we're getting into family stuff, which is a much deeper type of thing. So children obviously can be a glue that keeps a family together, and we can agree on how to raise our kids in the right way and what we agree. But it can also be a divisive issue for couples, in that you know, when things come up, I don't like the way you're disciplining our child. I don't like the way that you're addressing whatever situation the child might be having. That can be a divisive issue with couples, right? And so that's got to be a really difficult one to work through.
Well, yes. That's true. Yeah, that's true. And that's why I usually help people to really, you know, well, let me give you one practical tip. It helps a lot, especially with teenagers, to define just three things that parents can actually criticize them for. Not five, not 10, not many, but just three things. Like the one would be keeping your room clean. The second one will be not watching too much content on your phone. And the third one is coming home by, let's say, 10 p.m. And that's it. You pick three things and then you are not allowed to, you know, criticize your teenager for anything else.
Really? Like what? Like taking drugs? I mean,
yeah, if that's important for you, put it on the list.
Right. Okay. But it seems to me, you know, and I'm not really clear on how to phrase it, but it always seems to me that a woman can, or in many, this is the way I want to phrase it, in many instances, women will feel a more responsible for the child, or more entitled to, that's the word I wanted to use, definitely, more entitled to direct the development of a child than the father, just because of the natural part of the child came out of her body. So she feels more connected and more entitled, and I'm going to use that word again, to be the director of how this child's development will go. Am I wrong in that?
You're right.
So that can be an obstacle in relationship, because a father feels just as equally compelled to make sure that child's values and principles are aligned with his, and wants to make sure, and feels just as much of a duty to make sure that child grows up to be a good person. But because they didn't bear the child, they may feel like, wow, why should she have a greater say in how I discipline the child, or how I deal with them, you know, on issues of development and stuff. So, you know, how would you work through something like that, where the couple is at odds over a child and its development and discipline and all that stuff? Yes.
Yeah. you know, it's I don't really know where to start, because it's all about individual things. Well, let's say, for example, a child has a drug issue, as you mentioned.
Right. And
so is that, well, let's say the mother, she doesn't want to accept that, and the father wants to accept that. Right. So the question is how we reconcile that, right?
Right. So do you ever work with couples that are not together anymore over this issue of how to raise children? Because divorce is chronic, and parents have a kid or two and then split up, and then they share custody of their children. And often there can be difficulties at that point in child raising. Do you work with anybody on that kind of stuff?
Yeah, absolutely.
And so that has to be a pretty tricky water to navigate. I would think generally one parent would probably be the one pushing for this kind of stuff, and probably always looking for you to be the one to prove or to take their side on it.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah. Yeah. So that seems like a pretty difficult thing. So, you know, what in your training prepares you to deal with all that kind of, and sometimes it's got to get heated. No, it's got to get like angry and people becoming emotionally over the top. Is that stuff that you deal with, where people just losing their temper and it gets kind of really ugly and you have to step in as a referee?
Oh, look, usually I work with just one side of the relationship. So, for example, if just this week a client came in and he came to a session, he was very unhappy because he feels that his wife and his elder daughter, they like made a coalition against him. And so he was quite frustrated about it. And so I spent about 30 to 40 minutes just listening to him and calming him down.
Yeah, okay.
That's what I do.
All right. And I noticed in somewhere in your literature, maybe it's on the website or something, it says something about creating relationships that will be the envy of others or something like that. Does that ring a bell with you? Yeah. So my takeaway from that is, does it matter what other people think?
No, I mean, of course not.
Right. So being happy in your, I think a lot, and this is, it sounds like a trivial point, but I think this is a problem. It's been a problem for me. And so that's why I bring it up. It's been a problem for me in that I've been with women who look at other people's relationships and say, why can't our relationship be more like those, that couple? And that to me always says, well, you're only seeing that couple in our presence. You're not seeing them in their house with the doors locked, what goes on in their house, their arguments and fights and all that stuff. So judging other people and envying their relationship could cause problems for your relationship, right? Am I wrong or right in that?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
So this idea then, I think, again, I'm going to sound sexist here, but I think that idea of wanting that relationship that other people envy, I think that's generally a woman's perspective. They want that. They want to be in a relationship that their friends will look at and say, why can't we be more like them? Because when I got that, I've never heard a guy ever say, I wish our relationship was more like them. And I haven't really talked to my friends about it, but I will after this program. But is that generally a woman's perspective that I want our relationship to look more like theirs, to be more like theirs?
Generally, yes. Yeah, I would agree.
Yeah, that's a major frustration for guys like me who have tried to explain to women. Listen, you don't know their life. You don't know, and nobody ever knows anybody else's life. You can't know them until you walk a mile in their shoes, that old stuff. So you can't really know somebody from the outside looking in. You have to live their life. Right. Yeah. You want to elaborate on that or not?
The best example is Robin Williams. Everyone thought that he had a great life, but then he hanged himself.
Right. Well, I always talk about all these shows that I do. Every single podcast somehow ties into the past podcast. I did a show on suicide prevention last week with a comic comedian who actually does keynote speaking for this idea of suicide prevention. So, there's always a common thread that comes through it. But I don't think that necessarily... that idea, and I know we're getting off topic here, but the idea of somebody committing suicide means they were necessarily unhappy. What I'm learning is there are people who are born and I never really even knew this before. There are people who are preconditioned to have these thoughts of suicide right from birth. And I never thought of it as a genetic thing until I started talking to people who were experts in it. So you can actually be happy, be a happy or fulfilled person and have things going right in your life and end up killing yourself and not even really, I hate to say that that's, you're not unhappy. That it sounds weird, but you can be happy. You can have a happy life and still, because you're predisposed to this idea of suicide, whether for whatever reason they do it, it's still a possibility. And so it's still something I'm still trying to grasp the idea of. So you brought it up and I remember being angry when people were trying to make a hero out of, or saying what a great person, a great example Robin Williams was. And I was like, that suicide is, and this is what I said at the time. I'm not sure I, I believe that anymore. But what I said is suicide is the most selfish act anybody can commit. And all the joy that Robin Williams brought into the world, he kind of erased that by all the pain he put on people who experienced his suicide. So, but now I'm learning that that might not really hold true. So, you know, I think the biggest part of this is being open to learning and being able to reexamine what you believe about some of that stuff, yeah, as you learn more. So what is the big takeaway for the audience listening to this conversation? What would you like them to take away from it from this very brief conversation we've had?
Okay, even though you have confronted me on unconditional love a little bit, it's unconditional love, guys. It makes all the difference.
Right.
It's difficult to get to that place, but the journey itself of cultivating it in you, it's worth it.
Great. Well, I apologize if that felt like a confrontation. It wasn't meant for that.
I'm kidding.
Yeah, you know, I'm trying to really kind of come to grips with my own understanding of what unconditional love is. And it's not the first time I brought that up. Because other guests have mentioned unconditional love. I've had my stepdaughter say unconditional love to me a couple of times regarding different issues. And I always say, you know what? There are conditions to everything. And I know I brought up an extreme one, but there, you know, there are some that you don't even consider conditions until they happen. Until something goes wrong, and then you say, oh, yeah, that's a deal breaker for me. I never realized that was a deal breaker for me. So I hate to put it in that terms, but do you agree that a relationship is really a deal? It's a deal?
No way.
No?
I totally disagree.
In what way? I mean, because if we're talking about a contract, the contract is part of a deal, right? And a written agreement is part of a deal.
You know, in my perspective, the contract is there just to have a basic initial understanding. And it's not a deal because you come into the relationship not to trade, not to get your needs met. But first of all, you have a lot of love, unconditional love, and you go there to give. And you feel love not by your partner reciprocating to you, but just by giving love.
So lastly, before I let you go, I want to kind of touch on this idea. I guess I'll just come right out. Do people need to be in a relationship, or is it absolutely mandatory for necessary for happiness? Because there are some people who believe, and quite a few more people now I'm seeing believe that it's better off to be single. I'd rather be single. Is being in a relationship a vital part to being happy as a human being?
Yeah, that's my deep belief. I do believe that.
So, what would you say to people who just say, you know, I've just not cut out for relationships. I'm better off single.
Well, first of all, I will talk to them. I'll ask them questions to see where this thing is coming from, because it sounds like a sort of protection. They're protecting themselves from something.
Yeah, and I would agree.
And I will go from there. If they really feel that this is good for them, because there are people like that, definitely, I'll say okay. But if I see that a person is not taking any action because they actually they do want to have a relationship, but they're not taking action because they're finding excuses, then I will work on helping them with, you know, breaking through those excuses.
Would you agree that feeling of being in love is going to fade at some point, that being, you know, that eros, that romantic love that ignites a relationship, that's going to fade at some point in some way or another? And do you recommend ways to keep that, relight that spark, or does it just develop into something else and you have to let that go at some point?
Okay, so yeah, the first thing is that this thing, feeling in love and infatuation, it does wear off. It does wear off. To keep the spark going, you need to be intentional about it. And well, let's say one practical tip is creating a separate communication channel for love. let's say it's a separate email that you use only for love with your partner.
Huh. Very cool. That's a good idea. I never heard that one before. That's a new one on me. But it seems to make a lot of sense. I know my wife is big on me texting her at least once a day and telling her I love her. Just texting her a picture of flowers is something that seems to make her happy. So I'm going to have to do one now because after we get off this program, I tried to make that a habit. And because it's not part of my natural way of being. I have to actually go out of my conscious self, what I would normally do and think what would make her happy. So that becomes a hard habit to maintain. And so I'm just reminding myself now, is that what I just mentioned, that idea that you get something is really against your nature, so you have to keep it. You have to make an effort, really an active effort to say, what would make this person happy? Is that part of the recipe of maintaining a long-term relationship? Or
Totally. That's unconditional love. Exactly. Great example.
Well, I'm glad I could provide that because it actually is a reminder for myself to do it right now as soon as we get off this program. It's a subject where I said this in the beginning, I failed at more relationships than I've had, obviously. The one I'm in now with my wife is going on 13 years. It's the longest relationship of my life. But it hasn't been without struggles and a lot of hard things. And we're still, yeah, just yesterday we had an argument. And at the end of the day, tried to work it out in you know, just regular conversation and say, take the emotion out of it. And let's just talk about what happened today. And that becomes difficult. And nobody ever said life was going to be easy and it's like things are going to be easy. But having those conversations in and taking the emotion out of it is in my view, key, but it's also the most difficult thing because we are emotionally attached to our side of the story. Would you agree on that?
Yeah, I would agree. And a quick tip, do this on one day, just pick one day in the week, let's say Saturday, today, and postpone all criticism until that day. And and have a meeting, like 1 hour meeting, and take the turns. So let's say you speak first, and then for 30 minutes, and you give all the criticism that you wrote down during the week, and then your wife speaks and does the same.
Got any advice on how to divorce yourself from emotion in a conversation?
That's a very good tool because if you have an emotion like anger. So you write it down immediately. Don't voice it, but write it down instead. And then you voice it on Saturday when you sit down to have that meeting.
Wow. Yeah. Anger is a tough one. Anger is a tough one because, we've talked about this in a couple of podcasts about anger management and mindfulness and all that stuff. Anger seems to be the toughest one because, they say you're supposed to count to 10. Well, I'm too angry to even think that remember that I'm supposed to count to 10. So my fear about that, or my concern about that is in anger. Am I going to be able to have enough mindfulness? Ooh, I used a word that I don't even know what it means. Mindfulness, presence, state of mind to say, okay, I'm angry. Write that down. That's tricky, right?
It is tricky. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, this has been a kind of insightful program for me. Again, this is something I'm still working on at 61 years old. And I think a lot of people are you an optimist for relationships in general? Are you an optimistic person?
I am definitely.
All right. Well, Roman, thank you for your time today. Thank you for your insight. One more time with the website. It's romanmironov.com. And basically you can just contact them through there. And is there like a consultation thing that you do, or is there some kind of preliminary step they need to take when they get to your website?
Yeah, hit the contact tab and sign up for a no fee coaching session with me.
Great. Well, Roman, thank you for your time today. It's been great to pick your brain on some of this stuff and get to know you a little bit. I wish you great success moving forward, and thanks for being on the program.
Thank you so much, Matt. It's a pleasure.
Have a good day. Bye.
You too.
Roman Mironov, folks. Again, that's romanmironov.com. You can check out his website if you're interested in fixing a broken relationship, or just not even you're contemplating getting into a relationship and you want to make sure it's a healthy one right from the start. Again, I think, and this is just my takeaway from this, as to, my thoughts on the subject is, it's like everything. You don't rush into and I know he disagrees with my idea that it's a deal, but in a business deal, you would not just rush into something. You give it a lot of thought. You'd run it past your people who you deal with, and your attorneys even, and your friends and family, and kind of get an idea. You think this sounds like a good deal? And I think even if you take that part out of it, that it's a deal. The idea that you're getting into something long-term, and for it to work out long-term, you need to consider all these things before you rush into it. He recommends 2 months before you actually get into that committed relationship. Also, the other takeaway is, let the woman bring up the idea of relationship first. I think a lot of guys tend to make that mistake. They push for it because... And here's my instinct on that. I have no data to back this up whatsoever. I think a lot of guys do it thinking that's what the woman wants, wanting to be a pleaser. She wants this to be a relationship. Maybe I should bring it up now. And that could, in my case, in my personal experience, that has led to regretting some things. I'm in a relationship now that I never really wanted to be in. I got in it because I knew she wanted a relationship and would feel more comfortable, more safe with me. And I'm going to go here. I could get sex if I bring up the relationship first. And there's no denying that young men especially come from that mindset. Like if I tell her I love her, and even though I'm not really there yet, if I tell her I love her, I'm going to get her in bed a lot easier. That's the truth, folks. I try to speak my truth as I know it. I know I was like that when I was a young man, and I bet you a lot of young men have that same mindset. Been an interesting program. Relationships is not my forte, as you can tell, and I'm still trying to learn stuff. So I hope you got something out of it. I hope you enjoyed the program. Tell your friends about it. Come back, subscribe. Go to my YouTube channel, subscribe there. You know, patronize our sponsors. That's another thing. And for you folks on the audio side, which is almost everybody, I do these live streams daily at 1 p.m. and 8 p.m. for the offhand chance that some people might want to ask questions in real time. So join us for the live streams if you can on Facebook, on Periscope, on YouTube, on Twitch, a whole lot, and LinkedIn, a whole lot of platforms. We're available just about anywhere. If you can find me, Matt Knapp on MindDog TV. And go to MindDogTV.com and get on my mailing list so you can find out about upcoming guests. Again, I appreciate your time here on a Saturday afternoon. I wish you a great afternoon. Tonight, I'll be on at 8 p.m. with a young man, actually still a boy, 17, he's not 18 yet, who is a scientist and a TED Talk speaker and an expert in the field of evolution, and he's a wunderkind of science. So that should be a really, really interesting program. His name is Elliot Connor. Please join me tonight at 8 p.m. for that. Till then, I'm Matt Knapp for the MindDog TV podcast. Thanks for joining me, and bye for now.